name is Salman Hamid, and I'm Assistant Professor of Integrated Science and Humanities at Hampshire College.
I'm Kevin Anderson. I teach courses in film and anthropology at the University of Massachusetts, and this is Film Autopsy.
Am I interrupting? Thought you might be running low.
Pour yourself a glass, pal.
Thank you, but I'm afraid it would be wasted on me.
You think we wasted our time coming here, don't you?
Your question depends on me understanding what you hope to achieve by coming here.
What we hope to achieve was to meet our makers, to get answers. Why they even made us in the first place.
Why do you think your people made me?
We made you because we could.
Can you imagine how disappointing it would be for you to hear the same thing from your creator? May I ask you something?
Please do.
How far would you go to get what you came all this way for? Your answers. What would you be willing to do?
Anything and everything.
Hello, and welcome to a discussion addressing issues of science and creationism in Ridley Scott's new film, Prometheus. Now, I want to say from the outset, this discussion will include spoilers of the film. We've chosen science and creationism because those are two very kind of integral and centered themes to the film. How well Scott's film and the screenplay address those is really what's open for discussion.
It's a slightly disappointing film. Not slightly, actually. It's a lot of disappointment film because the story itself doesn't hold up. It's not really gripping story. But more than that, it aspires to talk about big issues. And big issues is, of course, that these characters, the main, the whole crew, is going to this planet on the spacecraft Prometheus to meet the makers. And the idea behind that is that there is an intelligent race out there that has engineered humans. And they have found these signs in the cave art
at various
locations, and which has the shades of Eric von Däniken's *Chariots of God*, which was a very sort of like popular book in the 70s. So on the surface, it's an interesting premise. Okay, what will happen when you find the race that created you? And I think that has so much promise because you can ask this question: well, what will you say to the people who have created you, if you were to meet them? What were the motivations and things like that? Unfortunately, in the film, all these questions were really dumbed down. And partly it was of the dumbing down of the science and scientists within it.
Yes.
And so that poses a bit of a problem.
Right. I think, I want to be fair to Ridley Scott here. Is he making something that he believes is on par with, say, Tree of Life, 2001 Space Odyssey, Solaris? I hope he would say no, because it's definitely not. Now, it is a film that deals with these larger questions about, you know, where did we come from, and you know, what would motivate us as humans to try to go, you know, meet our makers, and what kind of questions would we ask them? It is a dumbed-down version of those kind of much larger questions. There's problems within the story. I think the representation of the scientists within the film is really it's just sloppy. You know, like this biologist who goes up to this kind of, you know, xenomorph that looks like a snake, and he's practically going coochie, coochie, coochie. It's like, with his helmet, it's like ridiculous.
Well, or they just take the helmet off where all this oozing stuff around it, they go like, Or the geologist who cannot find anything to do on this completely unexplored planet. But the sloppiness also comes from the fact that it gives, right at the beginning when Prometheus is it actually gives the actual number, something in scientific notation, something 10 to the 14 kilometers.
The distance from Earth.
The distance from Earth. And so in my mind, because I was like, 10 to the 14 kilometers, that almost sounds like, you know, tens of light years away. But the distance was 2 years that they had traveled.
Yeah.
Okay, now, they may have traveled. This is end of the 21st century. Maybe they discovered faster than light travel. Fine. At least somebody should say that, like, you know, that they are going faster than the speed of light. Nothing. Okay, that's fine. But then Charlize Theron's character, and this was actually tweeted by Neil deGrasse Tyson, and I was reading about that, like, you know, he also picked that up of the same kind of issues, but also that Charlize Theron actually says, we are 500 million miles from the Earth. Now, here is the problem. Now, 500 million sounds a lot for, like, you know, when we are used to distances of the Earth, but not in astronomy. Half a billion actually puts you right a little beyond Jupiter. So for that, because it is 10 to the 14 kilometers range, you are talking about close to 6 trillion miles away, not half a billion. Okay.
Right.
Now, this is something, as a screenwriter, you are writing this film, like, you know, you have enormous budget. Why put those numbers, and why not just think about
and
what
I don't think we're nitpicking here. I mean, this is just, you know, a good screenwriter does research.
Right.
And, of course, in science fiction, you have, or in any writing, you have a lot of creative license, but that creative license is based on research that you've done, and then you've made it, you know, more dramatically interesting and more compelling and whatnot. But, yeah, just some of the basic math is wrong.
Right, I mean, the geologist, when he's saying he could not find anything what to do over there, well, I mean, that actually just shows the basic lack of understanding of how science or scientists were. Curiosity. That's a fundamental thing. I mean, if if you land on an unexplored planet, the first thing would be, whoa, what is that? Like, you know, every single thing would be phenomenal.
And maybe you'd send a drone out first?
Right. Not to bomb, by the way. I mean, there are drones.
Yeah, or a droid or a drone to go, you know, like, you know, assess the atmosphere, the geology, before you actually send him. I mean, okay. We're getting
just that, but they just go and drive out from the spacecraft. Like,
let's go into this ancient, alien pyramid and knock on the door and see what happens.
So there are these things which actually just showed, and which is fine. Again, he did that in Aliens too. I mean, I think you're right about the fact, like, you know, that he's not comparing it with 2001: Space Odyssey or Tree of Life and things like that. Those movies certainly did not. In this movie, with some of the questions, he's trying to ask those questions, and that's where some of the problems come in.
Well, let's get back to the creationism aspect, because that's touched on a number of levels. In the opening scene, that, like, this what they're called engineers in the film. They're kind of like almost superhumans, or maybe even post-humans. And his DNA decomposes and goes into the water and into the ecosystem. Supposedly that is the origins of humanity on Earth. Then there's the issue of one of the lead characters, Noomi Rapace, who is impregnated by her boyfriend, but he's been mutating, so the actual offspring inside her is part alien. Yeah.
And part octopus.
And then there's the issue of creationism around the creation of David, the android. Mm-hmm. So there seems to be an underlying theme about when you play God, there is a very strong price. And in that sense, it reminded me a little bit of Blade Runner, because Roy Batty, in the end of the film, goes to meet his maker and utters some very famous lines and then crushes his maker's skull. Right. In this version, they go to meet their makers, and it's the maker who starts, tearing them apart.
Right, and so that, again, that the makers...
The maker's not happy to see them.
Perhaps the makers realize, because they were trying to kill the humans, right? Yeah. I mean, that was one of those things. So
seems like they changed their mind.
They changed their mind, and that is and that is an interesting premise. Yeah. On paper, I think this would be an interesting aspect. Like, hey, if you met the maker, what made you change your mind? And that, I think...
And what would make a maker, change his mind about what you created
us? And this is one of those questions that I think you can explore at multiple levels, including David, the android.
Right.
Which, by the way, is the only... I mean, apart from the beauty of the film, the story is awful, but the movie itself is beautiful. The only other exception was Michael Fassbender
and his
David.
Especially...
Good. I love the scenes when he's watching Lawrence of Arabia and then he tries to speak like Peter O'Toole.
Yeah.
An absolutely charming, wonderful, beautiful scene.
I can carry out directives that my human counterparts might find distressing.
So that is actually really nice. But the questions of creationism are there. Noomi Rapace, I didn't like her in this film. And one of the things that almost bugged me towards the end, and apart from all the cliches that are there, who lives and who dies and the things crashing down and things like that, not much different than Independence Day, ID4,
no,
for example.
True.
But the issue of cross, very Christian symbolism in there.
Yes.
And, well, not very, it's obvious Christian symbolism in there. And that almost, and I know that this is sort of like the Hollywood version of, almost an ad for Christianity in that sense. Mm. So on the one hand, when we say, oh, this is about creationism and science, and are we going to talk about wealth? Does it go against evolution and things like that? Well, it's tricky because it's about humans engineering those things, yeah. but there is always this question, who engineered those superhumans yeah. and so on and so forth. All those questions should have been fine. But then he also brings up cross in a very yeah. specific yeah. way. And that almost, what did you think about that?
I thought it was too explicit. I mean, all you needed was for Noomi Rapace's character to be this archaeologist who believes in science, who follows, you know, is very committed to science, but also has a very strong spiritual belief. And so she is very determined and probably one of the most curious characters to go out there because her questions aren't just scientific. They're also spiritually based. And I think that's enough in and of itself to have the kind of very explicit use of the Christian cross that she has to wear around her neck. It's kind of juvenile screenwriting.
And at the end that she has to get the cross back and yeah. David, like, you know, is like, well, did you put the cross back? And he puts yeah. it back. I mean, that just seemed excessive. Yeah. But I should mention, I mean, one of the interesting aspects of it, I don't know how, you know, there are some UFO religions or religions based on extraterrestrial yeah. intelligence, I mean, or based on extraterrestrials. But aliens are much more explicit in which they say that, well, humans and all life form was created in a laboratory, like, you know, on some other planet, an undisclosed planet, and those makers are going to come back. They say that all the prophets, for example, were kind of crosses between the aliens and this. So anyway, so it's a very interesting. I'm just wondering, because this is kind of the terrain that they fall under.
Yeah.
It would be fantastic to see, for example, how do they react
right.
to a movie like that where the whole notion is fundamentally based that, well, and Raelians are interesting because Raelians consider themselves as an atheist religion.
Right.
And their
right.
other tagline is, finally, science meets religion, because okay. they are referring to the fact that, well, they're not saying there is God out there. All they're saying is that they were engineered by very advanced aliens.
The one thing I will say is, I imagine there will be two more films.
I think the sequels are all set. Yeah.
These questions, we're just hoping, we're praying, will be dealt with in a more mature way, in a smarter way, in a more nuanced way in the successive films.
I mean, there are hopes in the sense that, because they leave it open, that now they are looking for the makers of the makers
yeah.
in some sense, or where did the makers go?
Right.
Like, you know.
Because the makers are not immortal.
And they're not
yeah,
there.
That's key. And they're not on this planet.
And they're not on this planet. Yeah. So they've left. So that's an interesting question of where yeah. they are. And so you open up basically the whole universe to go. And I think, I hope that in that universe...
That's only a little over a billion miles long.
And I hope that in that universe they will find better screenwriters. Because yes. all it takes is a good screenwriter to
get
actually...
A Raelian. Joss Whedon and a Raelian.
And I think... Bang good screenwriting can really address the scope is enormous. The yeah. scope has so much potential.
Yeah.
You just need a good story. Don't like you know.
Don't me.
Yeah. Rubbish. Like, you know. You know.
All right, that's our discussion on science and creationism in Prometheus. Check out the film, and please send your comments to our blog.
And in fact, Ridley Scott should watch the first part again and the first 5 minutes.
Yeah.
That was just...
Yeah. I'd love to hear from Ridley. See what he has to say.